Good afternoon, everyone. After witnessing the heroic surgeries, I'll be discussing on a more dry but important topic, cystoid macular edema post-cataract surgery, when and how to treat. So CME developing following cataract surgery, and if its cause is thought to be directly related to the surgery, it's referred to as Ewing-Gass syndrome or pseudophakic CME. Post-cataract CME is mostly self-limited, but for chronic CME or in cases of multiple recurrences, there is photoreceptor damage with permanent impairment of central vision may result. The pathophysiology, we all know, it's CME following cataract surgery is most likely caused by the cytokines released by the activated inflammatory cells. These molecules lead to breakdown of the blood-retinal barrier, and there is capillary leakage. The enzyme phospholipase causes the release of arachidonic acid. Subsequently, cyclooxygenase converts arachidonic acid to prostaglandin. Prostaglandins cause breakdown of the blood-retinal barrier. The enzyme phospholipase can be inhibited by steroids and NSAIDs. Another product of arachidonic acid breakdown involves the enzyme lipooxygenase, which converts arachidonic acid to leukotriene, which is a chemotactic agent. The exact role of leukotrienes in CME is not very clear, and there are currently no lipooxygenase blocking agents. So looking at the natural history, approximately 20% of patients who undergo uncomplicated phacoemulsification or ECC, which we don't do much nowadays, this is an old study, they develop angiographically proven CME. But angiographically proven CME is not what we look for, because we are concerned only if there is a clinical significant decrease in the visual acuity, which we see only in about 1% of these eyes. Incidence of clinically apparent CME is much higher in complicated cataract surgeries. The association between rupture of the anterior vitreous phase and development of aphakic CME has been proposed by several authors. The hypothesis that vitreomacular traction causes CME has also been confirmed histopathologically. Post-operative CME is clinically significant. CME usually occurs within 3 to 12 weeks post-operatively, but in some cases it may be delayed for months or many years after surgery. The spontaneous resolution of CME with subsequent visual improvement may occur within 3 to 12 months in almost 80% of the patients. We look at a case, this is a 55 years old diabetic patient presented with complaint of blurring of vision in the right eye about 3 months after uneventful MICS plus PCIOL. Previously, documentation of the fundus before cataract and even post-operatively did not show any diabetic retinopathy. The best corrected visual acuity had dropped to 624. The anterior segment was quiet. The PCIOL was in place in the bag. The fundus showed CME. There was no diabetic retinopathy. This is the OCT picture showing subfoveal fluid with cystoid spaces. So in this case, we started treatment with topical prednisolone acetate eye drops. That's one drop 4 times daily, and nepafenac 0.1% eye drop, one drop 3 times daily, following which the CME resolved. This is the usual response which we get in almost 80% of uncomplicated post-cataract CMEs. They mostly resolve with proper treatment with topical steroids and NSAIDs. Now, the topical steroids used could be prednisolone acetate, could be difluprednate or loteprednol. The choice goes to the clinician. Difluprednate obviously has a higher intraocular pressure raising capability, which we should always be prepared. And topical NSAIDs, again, nepafenac, bromfenac, ketorolac, flurbiprofen, diclofenac, they have all been used. Most clinicians favor nepafenac or bromfenac these days. Topical steroids are normally tapered after a positive response, while topical NSAIDs are usually continued 2 to 3 months post-resolution. The non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, they prevent prostaglandin synthesis from arachidonic acid through the inhibition of cyclooxygenase as well. Now, how do we, certain protocols are, there is no strict protocol of treatment as such in post-op CME, but most specialists agree that the first-line treatment, as mentioned, is a combination of a topical corticosteroid and a topical NSAID. In the majority of cases, CME resolves with this treatment regimen, and other treatment modalities are utilized much less frequently, like periocular or intravitreal steroids. Therefore, it is important that the clinicians determine which topical medications provide the best chance to resolve the CME. Prospective studies of subjects receiving NSAID treatment following phacoemulsification and IL implantation, both Bromfenac 0.09% ophthalmic solution dosed BD and Nepafenac 0.1% ophthalmic solution suspension dosed TID, are well tolerated and resulted in positive clinical outcomes. The Bromfenac displayed a better ocular penetration due to its lipophilic property and duration permitting twice daily dosing. One significant biochemical difference is that Nepafenac is a prodrug. So Nepafenac penetrates the cornea and is hydrolyzed to the active metabolite Mfenac. The active metabolite is believed to inhibit the action of prostaglandin H synthase 6, while Bromfenac inhibits prostaglandin synthesis by inhibiting cyclooxygenase 1 and 2. Bromfenac chemical structure is identical to Mfenac with the exception of the bromide atom at the C4 position. The addition of bromine enhances the lipophilicity, and facilitates penetration, and increases duration of half-life. It's important to know these pharmacological characteristics of these drugs because these are very important drugs which are widely used in the treatment of CME in clinical practice. And most of the time, 80% of the time, the patient responds with topical treatment. Now, regarding Nepafenac, the prodrug form is neutral, which is believed to result in greater corneal permeability than the acidic structures in the conventional NSAIDs. Nepafenac 0.1% reached anterior chamber aqueous concentrations about 3.6 times higher than ketorolac and 8 times higher than Bromfenac. The time to greatest concentration was also shortest for Nepafenac, signifying faster penetration. There is very little conversion of Nepafenac to Mfenac within the cornea, allowing full rapid penetration into the eye of the prodrug. The high intraocular concentration of Nepafenac may act as a reservoir for continuous production of Mfenac. Now comes the question, what do we do if there is no response to topical steroids and NSAIDs? Here we have a 60-year-old lady who presented with blurring of vision in right eye 4 weeks after uneventful cataract surgery. Fundus evaluation before cataract surgery had shown findings of early dry RMD with ERM. On examination, the best corrected visual acuity was 618. Anterior segment findings were quite high with PCIOL in the bag. The fundus was showing CME with ERM macula. So this is the picture, the OCT picture. So again, we started initial treatment with topical steroids and NSAIDs, Nepafenac, but there was no improvement in BCV or reduction in CME after 6 weeks. So we went to the next line. We injected posterior subtenons triamcinolone acetonide injection. Initially, the CME reduced, but there was a recurrence after 1 month, and patient turned out to be a steroid responder. There was a rise in IOP. What do we do? The CME is back. We tried, those were the days of Avastin, although this is an old patient from 2015. Avastin did not evoke a positive response either. So the question comes, do we go for Ozurdex? It's a steroid responder, mind you, but then again, Ozurdex has a much lower propensity to increase IOP as compared to triamcinolone acetonide, be it intravitreal, be it posterior subtenons. This is an important point which should be, which we have seen in clinical practice, and even the IOP rise which we see with Ozurdex is mostly easily controllable with topical anti-glaucoma drugs. The points of discussion again is to emphasize, basically we have to decide which topical NSAID is best. We have to decide whether we need steroids in periocular form. Topical steroids are always required, although initial studies, any initial reports say that certain CMEs respond to NSAIDs alone. And role of anti-VEGFs, then obviously intravitreal Ozurdex, IVTA, the last resort. Now we come to certain special situations which most clinicians come across in their day-to-day practice, like post-op CME in diabetes. Diabetes is a condition most of the surgeons encounter, the anterior segments surgeons encounter, and it's very important to have a good posterior segment evaluation in a patient with diabetes who is due for cataract surgery to decide the pre-op management before the cataract surgery if required. Cataract surgery in diabetic patients result in a dramatic acceleration of pre-existing diabetic macular edema, leading to poor functional visual outcome. This can be prevented provided the severity of the retinopathy and maculopathy is recognized preoperatively and treated appropriately. I'll no, not go into the details. I'll straight away go to a case. Like, here is a patient with diabetic macular edema and cataract. The FFA is showing leaking microaneurysms in the FAZ. The OCT is showing macular edema. So do we treat the cataract here first, or do we treat the macular edema? We should treat the macular edema first. So we started the treating the, this was August 2018 picture, with series of anti-VEGF injections between September 2018 and February 2019. The macular edema resolved, and then the cataract surgery was done. This is the cataract surgery, post-cataract surgery picture with the resolved DME. And however, the patient has a recurrence after 3 months. There is, again, cystoid spaces. Now, this is a condition where there is pre-existing macular edema due to diabetes. This is diabetic maculopathy. The best is to retreat with anti-VEGF injections or Ozurdex in such cases. So there is a fair resolution of macular edema after giving 2 more monthly intravitreal anti-VEGF injections with focal laser. A long-term follow-up is required in such cases. Similarly, anti-VEGFs, Ozurdex may be the treatment of choice in recurrent CME post-cataract surgery in previous treated patients of RVOs. Now, in post-op CME in diabetic retinopathy without pre-op maculopathy, here we may try topical steroids and NSAIDs, and if there is a response, it's well and good. If there is no response, in such cases, we can consider posterior subtenons, triamcinolone acetonide. If still no response, then we can consider anti-VEGFs, Ozurdex after confirming presence of leaking microaneurysms in FAZ on FFA. A little bit on uveitis and cataract surgery, just I need just a minute because this is a very important topic. So it is always important to treat pre-existing uveal inflammation and CME with topical, systemic, and periocular steroids. Pre-operative CME in uveitis usually requires posterior subtenons, triamcinolone acetonide. Non-responders may require intravitreal triamcinolone or Ozurdex in non-infectious uveitis. Can I take a minute? Caution should be exercised in steroid responders, and it's important to plan the cataract surgery only after CME has resolved and the eye is free of inflammation for at least 3 months. Cystoid macular edema is one of the leading causes, and this patient had persisting CME post-cataract surgery. He's a patient of intermediate uveitis, and finally it responded to topical prednisolone acetate and nepafenac eye drops itself. But most of such cases, they require post-op subtenons, triamcinolone acetonide. In the setting of, if CME is not responding to topical steroids and NSAIDs, then in the setting of associated active vitritis, choroiditis, or vasculitis, oral steroids or immunosuppressives or posterior subtenons, triamcinolone acetonide, if systemic steroids are contraindicated. IVTA or Ozurdex may be considered in selected cases of non-infectious uveitis where systemic steroids are contraindicated or posterior subtenons is ineffective. If CME is not responding to topical steroids and NSAIDs and there is no associated active inflammatory vitritis, choroiditis, then the first option is posterior subtenons, triamcinolone acetonide. If it doesn't respond, then we have to go for either IVTA or Ozurdex. Anti-VEGFs may be required in steroid responders. I think I'll finish it off here because I'm out of time. So I've tried to cover the situations where anterior segment surgeons are likely to encounter post-op CME and the ways of the modalities of management. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Arindam, for your presentation.